So welcome so much, Maria, and thank you for joining me today. It's lovely to meet you.
Yeah, thank you. It's nice to be here.
Thank you. So I'm excited to chat all things English to you, football, and potentially even golden retrievers, as I hear you have one. I do too, so I'm a big fan. But I just wanted to start with your experience of learning English. And I just wanted to hear about sort of, can you tell us what inspired you to learn the language and what age did you start?
In Norway, we start learning in English in school when we're, I think it's around 7, 8 years old. I don't know how it is now, but I remember we were 7, 8 years old. So yeah, we learned it in school, just the basic. I wasn't a really fan, to be honest. It was hard. But when I moved to England in 2017, I had to learn it and speak it.
You actually touched on this a little bit there, but I was going to say that obviously learning a new language can be very challenging. Did you find the process challenging, or what did you find particularly hard about it?
Yeah, it was a completely new language. We were young, we were just kids, but that's when you learn the best. So I remember I was struggling a lot with, like, we had to learn the he, she, it, is, you are, they are, and all that. And I just didn't understand why it was like that. So that's something I remember a lot. What else? Just to build sentences.
Yeah.
And also now, after moving to England, in the beginning, I remember I always translated Norwegian into English. So I build sentences on what I would say in Norway.
Right.
But okay. it didn't come properly out in English, so it didn't make sense sometimes. But now I feel like I know more how to build sentences in English. So yeah, I've improved a lot since I was a kid. I would say it's helped me a lot. I think I realized how important it is when I moved to England. Before, I just kind of, it went along, like I could use it when I traveled around, but I wasn't really good speaking it, but I did understand most of the English. But now I see the beneficial of actually being able to speak it properly, write, read, understand. And it's the only language you have to know really to be able to speak to everyone in the world. So yeah.
Yeah, it's so true. And those connections you just naturally build people just by being able to speak English, it must help a lot. When you think of today's students who might now be sat in a school in Norway learning, or anyone that's potentially moved to the UK and is now trying to pick it up as they go along as well, would you have any advice to them?
It will be hard, but it's just about not giving up, and also, like, don't be afraid to try and speak, because I remember it took me a while to actually have the confidence to start talking to my teammates, and when I started to be more comfortable, they got more comfortable to actually help me to pronounce things right. So it's all about, like, help each other out, and yeah, just trust yourself and just jump into it. It is really hard, but you will get there.
You recently graduated with a distinction, I believe, in your MBA in business administration. So congratulations. That's quite an achievement. And I just wanted to hear a little more about sort of what made you decide to take that qualification and sort of what you hope it will achieve in the future.
Longford International College, they got in touch with Chelsea and asked if we wanted to try this. What do you call it?
The qualification or a...
Yeah, the qualification. And we were a group of players that actually wanted to, because for us footballers, it's really hard to finish school or do something at the university because you are quite busy, so you can't be there. So for my reason, I had to stop my, I did nursery in Norway, but I had to quit because they didn't have the chance to adapt for my schedule. So at that time, I didn't have anything no education, and it is important to have something. So when this opportunity came up, I was like, I should just jump on it and see how it goes. And they were really good to like adapt and help, at least like they were really good to help. So I would not have made it without their help on the way. But now sitting here and I'm done, I'm so proud and so happy that I actually finished it. So it was really hard. I got a lot of help, but I made it in the end. So I'm very proud, actually.
You so should be. And I think that's, it is an incredible achievement. And it's listening to you speak, it's interesting to hear, you know, that importance of education that you mention. Do you sort of, where do you take inspiration from for that? Is that from family members? Is that from friends?
Yeah, it's both. I feel like it's a big thing. I don't know if it's everywhere, but back home, it's like you have to have an education to get a job, blah, blah, blah. You don't have to, but I feel like for myself, it's a really good like security, because in football, you never know. Like now I'm injured. You never know if an injury is going to happen and it will end your career. And then you sat there and you don't have anything to go back to. But now I can kind of relax because I know I at least have something to go back to when my football career is over. So it's really nice. If I didn't have it, I would be a bit more stressed, and have in the back of my mind that I have to study when I stop playing football. And that's not really something I want to do. So I'm glad I'm done. And yeah, at least I have something.
We have obviously the Women's World Cup starting this month. I know you just mentioned you're injured, which is, I'm so sorry to hear. But are you still excited for the tournament? How are you feeling about it?
It's a bit of a mixed emotion. We played the Euros last year and it was a very bad experience. One of my worst tournaments ever. So for me, I was looking forward to the World Cup to actually come back and have to bounce back. So I've used that as a motivation the whole year because it's been really tough, really knocked my confidence down. And then I was in a good place, never felt better. And unfortunately, I got the injury in March, and ruled me out for the World Cup. So I am excited for the girls that's going to play for Norway now and for my teammates as well. So I will follow it. I will watch the games, but I'm trying also to like avoid it a bit because it is hurt. It does hurt, because I really want to be there. But right now it wasn't meant to be this year. So yeah.
Oh, and well, I wish you a very speedy recovery as well. And I think, yes, you've got a very balanced approach of looking at it. So, but yeah, I wish you all the best in terms of getting back to the game as soon as you possibly can. And when did you realise you wanted to play football professionally? Was it something you had always been interested in from a very young age, or did it sort of happen organically?
I've always been an active kid. And if I look back on the pictures from me when I was a little girl, like I always had a ball either in my hands or my feet. So I did a lot of sports, but I ended up playing handball and football. I don't know, in England, you don't really know what handball is, I don't think.
No.
No, I know. I tried to explain some teammates, but they don't understand it. But anyway, it's a big sport in Norway. Not similar to football, but kind of the same. It's hard to describe. Anyway, but yeah, I started playing football when I was maybe 6-7 years old and just loved it. And played handball, football professionally in both, actually, till I was 18. I actually chose handball. I chose handball in 2012, and wanted to like see how far I could come there. But unfortunately, I had a patella tendon injury. So, and I also missed football. So in 2014, I went back to football. And from there, the journey has just gone like, yeah, this way. So now I'm in Manchester United and I'm just loving my life.
How important do you think it is for young girls who want to get into sport to see this? And did you... did you get to see these sort of things when you were younger, or do you think it's much better now?
Oh, it's definitely much better. I'm very jealous of the girls that's young now and have the future ahead. When we were kids, we didn't really see women's football on TV, or not even in the newspaper. It was maybe like a little piece of like writing. But now you have social media, you have TV, you have it covers everywhere. So then you can follow your profiles and the people you look up to. And also it's a nice feeling for myself and for the rest of the girls, I think, to like be the ones that make the way for the younger kids, to be able to be along the, or be how do you say it? I've been on the journey from I was 15, and I can see now 15 years after how big the women's football have got, and it's still growing, and to see the difference from back then to now, how massive it is. And yeah, so I think the World Cup and the Euros last year in England, definitely when they won it, it made it much bigger in England. Like, it's huge. And I think it will just continue. So the young girls and boys are lucky.
Oh, and what advice would, you know, you mentioned earlier about, you know, that importance of an education, and I guess doing that so that you always have another choice. What advice would you give to a young girl or boy that is kind of like, I want to be a footballer, or I want to get into sport? What would you say to them?
I would definitely say follow your dreams, because you can see there is possibilities. Not everyone will make it, but there is a chance. But also for me, it's always been, I've never been the one that's going to be the best. I've always just, it sounds weird, but I've always just played and had fun. Aww. And I've ended up where I am. I've been lucky to have the talent as well, but for me, it's all about having fun and enjoy it first of all. But I think the thing is, they don't see the things behind the scenes. So the life of a footballer is not great all the time. You don't just play football and it's like happy all the time. It's a lot of tough stuff behind it. So it's tough, but it's fun. And I think having a education is very important as well, because you can't play football for the rest of your life, unfortunately. So it is important to have something to come back to.
That's very good, sound advice. And it actually ties in very nicely to my last question, which is, you've mentioned this a little bit, you know, just then you said there is another side, obviously, which is probably very hectic, busy, lots of commitments, probably lots of travel away from friends, family. How do you manage that balance? And, you know, when we think of looking after ourselves and our mental health and our well-being, how do you take the time to make sure that you have time for you to relax and look after yourself, really?
I think what we do have a lot of is time for ourselves. You go to training in the morning, and you're in for 6 hours, and then you come home and you're quite tired, so you try to like just recover and get ready for the next day. So you're, especially for us coming abroad, we don't have family there, so we're quite a lot alone, unless like we are really good to do stuff with the team and with my teammates, because we're such a good group of girls, so we do stuff together. But it is lonely sometimes. And say if you get injured, or if you have a period where it doesn't go well for yourself, it is tough to be there alone. You miss your friends' weddings, having kids' birthdays. Like, you miss a lot from home. So you have to like, how do you say it? You have to sacrifice a lot. But at the same time, if you look on the other side, we get to experience a lot of things that my friends and family will never be able to, so it's two sides of it. But one thing that really helps me is my dog. So he's the one that makes the day goes by. Like, he yeah he keeps me entertained all day.
They are amazing for that. And also I always think the requirement of needing exercise, they get you out of the house, they always give you that sort of purpose, that thing to do. How old is your retriever?
Theo is 7 and a half now.
Oh
yeah, getting older.
Oh, I have a 2-year-old golden retriever. Oh. And he is top level of puppy excitement all the time. Yeah. So I hope they calm down a bit, but
they do.
Well, thank you so much for talking to me today. It's been lovely to hear your story and your journey of learning English and how that's really helped form now into your professional career as a footballer as well. So I really appreciate your time, and it's been really great to hear all about your experience and advice. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having me. It was nice.